What a great start to the morning. What a great start to the new year, isn't it? Aren't you glad you're here this morning? I want to ask you to do me a favor. I know especially, you know, most of our guests and people that don't know us very well are going to hate this, and maybe our members will too, but I'm going to have you do me one favor. When I say go, I want you to physically stand up from, you know, in where you are. I'm not going to have you move anywhere, but just kind of stand up, turn around, tell somebody around you, if you don't know them, tell them your name. If you do know them, you know, reintroduce yourself if you want to, and then tell them one thing you're looking forward to about 2017. I'll give you about 3 seconds to think of an answer. One, two, three. Okay, everybody stand up. Stand up. Tell somebody around you, this is what I'm looking forward to in 2017. All right, have a seat, please. Now, I don't know for sure, but that sounded like a lot of good stuff. Hopefully, we're going to do some pretty big things. God's going to do some pretty big things through us in 2017. I'm looking forward to it. Are you? I really am. I'm looking forward to the next few weeks. With the sermon series that's already been talked about this morning. I want to start out by telling you this morning about, you know, something that I haven't done in many years, but I used to really enjoy doing it back when I was a much younger man than I am now, and that was going rappelling. Has anybody ever been rappelling before? A few of you have. Does anybody know what the word rappelling means? A few of you do. Okay. All right, let's go ahead and have that first pick, if you don't mind. This is about a little over 20 years ago. This is somewhere, I'm being serious, this is somewhere south of Harrison. I don't remember exactly where we were. I'm the guy over on the far left, that's me, waiting my turn to go over the side of this bluff right here. It was about a 200-foot drop. I used to love going rappelling back in my younger days, and I'd still go now. It's not that I wouldn't go now, it's just I don't have the opportunity, and I weigh a lot more now than I did in that picture there, so let's make sure we got a strong rope if I ever go again. Now, if you've never been rappelling before, and you can see, Reagan, that's Terry Schnockenberg right there getting ready to go over the side. If you see Terry right here, there's especially the first time you go rappelling, there's this moment when you're at the edge, and it doesn't matter if it's just, you know, a few feet up or if it's a whole bunch of feet up in the air, where you have to start leaning back and keep leaning and keep leaning until basically you're in a seated position, so that gravity does its job and there's tension on the rope and you begin to basically walk down the side of a cliff or hang from it, whichever the case might be. And it's that moment, the first time especially when people go rappelling, that's kind of the critical moment. And when me and my buddies used to go rappelling, we'd take somebody with us for the first time. There's a lot of people that would get to that edge and would start leaning back and get part of the way back and go, no, no, pull me up. I want up. I don't want to do this. I don't want to do this. And you try to encourage them. You try to be like, go ahead. You're fine. You're safe. Everything's fine. Nothing's going to happen. You're going to be okay. No, pull me up. Pull me up. And some of you are going, that'd be me. Some of you are going, I'd have been taking the picture. I'm not even on the cliff right now. It's that moment of commitment. It's that moment of deciding, I'm going to go ahead and go over the edge. I'm going to take that next step. And what I want to challenge you with this morning is that this is where many of us may be finding ourselves right now. Not that we're standing on the edge of a cliff, getting ready, you know, attached to a rope, getting ready to go over the side of it. But some of us have some big steps that maybe we need to start taking in our lives. There's some of us that want to have a better marriage than we do right now. There's some of us that, you know, want to do a better job with our parenting, or maybe we want to be better kids for our parents. There's some of us that want to make sure to work harder and get a good salary, a better salary. There's some of us that want to do better with our health. We want to grow in our faith. We want to have a stronger faith. We want to have some more solid friendships. We just want to have more success in life, whatever that looks like and however we define it. And we can look at our lives, and we can look at our families, and we can look at our church involvement, and we can look at our friendships and even look at our faith, and we can say, why aren't things better? Why isn't my faith stronger? Why does my debt seem to keep getting bigger and bigger? Why does my marriage seem to keep getting shakier and shakier? Why does my addiction keep winning over and over again? And maybe for some of us, even if things aren't getting any worse, they're not getting any better. And there's lots of reasons that that might be happening. There's lots of different circumstances that might be happening to us that are beyond our control. And there's some consequences that we're suffering now because of choices that we've made over the last few months or even the last few years. But one of the biggest factors, I believe, has to do with being committed. Being willing to be fully committed to whatever it is that I'm trying to accomplish, whatever it is that I need to improve. I get to the edge of the cliff. I'm right at the jumping off point. I'm ready to take the next step, but I'm not willing to do it. I'm not willing to commit to it. I'm not willing to take that next step of faith. Maybe I'm afraid of it, or maybe I just don't know how it's going to turn out, so I'd rather just not even try. Pulling back up. I don't want to do this. Folks, it's time to take the next step. It's time for some of us to leap. It's time to move forward. And that's what we're going to focus on today and for the next few weeks, is being fully committed, taking that next step. And I want to give you a picture this morning from Scripture of what that looks like. If you want to open your Bibles to the Old Testament, to the book of 1 Samuel, and you can, you know, look in your table of contents if you need to, go in your Bible app, find the book of 1 Samuel. It's in the Old Testament. And in chapters 13 and 14, we won't read through the whole thing, but there's a story there that's told of King Saul. Saul was the first king over the nation of Israel. And one of his enemies, one of Israel's enemies, pretty much throughout Saul's reign, was a group of people called the Philistines. And the Philistines and the Israelites were at war with each other. And Saul had gone and attacked the Philistines, and the Philistines were going to retaliate. And it just so happened that Saul had about 3,000 soldiers with him, and they're camped out on a bluff overlooking a valley. And the Philistines show up on the bluff on the opposite side of the valley, looking back over at the Israelites. And like I said, Saul had 3,000 soldiers with him, and the Philistines, well, they had more soldiers than you could count. They had as many as the sands on the seashore, Scripture says. There's chariots and there's horses and there's soldiers everywhere as far as the eye can see. And so Saul is sitting on his bluff looking across at all these Philistines that he can't count. And all the Philistines are looking back at him and nothing's happening. And the next day nothing happens. And the next day nothing happens. And the next day nothing happens. And finally Saul's son Jonathan gets tired of this. And Jonathan comes up with a plan. And Jonathan has what's called an armor bearer, another guy that would be with him that would carry extra swords and shields and spears and whatever weapons, but was also very adept at using those things. Kind of his second in command. And Jonathan comes to his armor bearer and he tells his armor bearer, I've got a plan. Here's what we're going to do. There's umpteen thousand Philistines over there. Yes. Okay, what you and I are going to do, yeah, we're going to go attack them. What? That'd be my reaction anyway. Say that again. I missed the part. I seriously thought you said the two of us are going to attack all of them. That's the plan. Oh, but it gets better. Here's Jonathan's big plan. We're going to climb down our bluff. We're going to go out into the valley. We're going to make sure that they see us. And then, if they say, hey, you guys wait down there at the bottom of the cliff and we'll climb down to you, we know that we're going to need to run away because God's not with us and we're not going to win. But if they say, hey, you climb up here where all the rest of the thousands of us are, we're going to know God's given them into our hand. Think about that for a moment. Think about Jonathan coming to you and saying, here's the deal. Here's what we're going to do. And here's how we know God's going to be with us. Would you volunteer? If you were the armor bearer, I mean, I'm serious. There would part of me be like, no, thank you. Go find another armor bearer. Go find somebody. You know, I heard somebody else wants to go on a suicide mission. Go get him. This isn't what I signed up for. Or maybe I would go, but I would go because he's going to make me go. It's the king's son telling me I have to go do this. And so I'm like, well, yeah, I'll go. I don't want to go. I'd be dragging my feet the whole way. And I'd almost be ready to run back the other way. I might even tell Jonathan, hey, you go ahead. I'm right behind you. Way behind you, right? I want you to look at the reaction that the armor bearer has. This is in 1 Samuel chapter 14 and verse 7. When Jonathan presents him the plan, he responds, "Do all that you have in mind. Go ahead. I am with you, heart and soul." He doesn't say, "I'm going with you because I have to." He doesn't say, "I'm going with you because you're making me go." He doesn't say, "I'm going with you because I'm bored and there's nothing else to do." He says, "I'm going with you, and I am with you in this endeavor, heart and soul. No matter what happens, no matter how this turns out, no matter what it takes, I am with you." Folks, that's what we're talking about this morning. That's the kind of commitment that we're looking for. That's what it means to be truly committed to something. We have to be willing to have that kind of commitment. We have to be willing to say, "I'm committed. I'm in this. I'm committed to it. I'm devoted to it. I'm in this heart and soul. I am committed to conquering my addiction, no matter how many times it's conquered me. I'm committed to being a better parent, even if that means I've got to change some habits and some attitudes. I'm committed to spending more time in prayer, even if that means letting go of something else. I'm committed to volunteering more, even if it's out of my comfort zone. I'm committed to letting go of my anger. I'm committed to being a better spouse. I'm committed to making better choices for my health. I'm committed to giving more to this church. I'm committed to getting out of debt. I'm committed for the first time in my life to choosing a relationship with Jesus Christ." It's more than just words. It's more than just going through the motions. It's confessing. It's proclaiming to all who will hear, "I'm in this." Heart and soul. I'm committed. I'm committed even when no one else is. Sometimes committing myself to change in my life means that I'm the only person committing myself to change. That everybody else that I hang out with is doing their own thing, and maybe I've been doing the same things with them, but now I'm going to be doing something different. But I'm committed to doing something different even if nobody else is. My coworkers may not commit to working harder or being more respectful to our superiors. I may have to do that on my own. My spouse may not commit to making changes in our relationship like I am. My circle of friends may not stop doing ungodly things and trying to get me to do those things as well. My friends, maybe even my fellow church members, may not commit to giving more or to spending more time in prayer or to spending more time in the Word. My unchurched friends may not recognize or even see the need for any of the things that I'm choosing to commit myself to. But I need to be committed to whatever it is that I see needs to change in my life, even if no one else does. I also sometimes need to be committed to action that needs to be taken when no one else is taking action. I need to commit to recognizing needs of people around me and moving to action to meet those needs, even if nobody else is. Jesus tells a story in Luke chapter 10 of a guy that's going down the road and gets jumped by robbers, and they beat him up, leave him for dead, and take all of his stuff with him, just leave him laying on the side of the road. And as Jesus tells the story, there's not one but two church people that come walking by and see him there and make sure to keep their distance a little ways as they keep on walking. There was a need. And in their defense, it's not like they beat him up. It's not like they left him for dead. It's not like they took all of his stuff. Somebody else had done all that. But they had the opportunity to do something about it, and they didn't. One person did. A Samaritan came along and saw they needed help, and he helped him. Sometimes my commitment to doing something needs to take place even if no one else is doing anything. God tells us tells his people in Exodus chapter 23 and verse 2, "Do not follow the crowd in doing wrong." Then God calls his people to keep away from the crowd when the crowd is going in the wrong direction. When everybody else is doing something that God doesn't want them to do, God says, "Stay away from that." But I believe that God is also, in this command, is also calling us to move to action when the rest of the crowd doesn't. Sometimes doing nothing is the wrong thing to do. Sometimes we need to be a people of action when no one else is. Don't follow the crowd in doing nothing. When the opportunity is there, do something about it. Jonathan and his armor bearer could have sat and done nothing. That's what everybody else was doing. That's what Jonathan's dad, the king, was doing. But they chose to take action even when no one else did. That's the kind of commitment we need to have as well. I'm committed even when no one else is. I'm committed even when it stretches me. Even when it moves me beyond my comfort zone. Even when it's something I've never tried before. Oftentimes the reason that I need to change actions and the reason that I need to move forward and the reason that I need to do something new and something different in my life is because I've gotten stuck where I'm at. My marriage might be in a rut. My faith might be completely stagnant. My service may be non-existent. I may have a broken relationship or more than one, and they just continue to stay that way. And the reason is, oftentimes, that in order for something to be different, I have to be willing to not only change, but maybe even to be stretched and to be made uncomfortable. It stretches you when you're standing on the edge of a bluff attached to a rope and you go over the side for the first time. It's a little awkward. It's uncomfortable. It stretched Jonathan's armor bearer when the plan called for 2 versus 200,000. That's uncomfortable. That's stretching yourself. When God puts it on your heart to improve your marriage, to walk away from an addiction, to serve someone in need, to trust Him when things get tough and you don't know what the answers are, it stretches you to continue to commit to whatever it is that He's calling you to commit to. Jesus said there's people in this world that fall into two categories. Old garments and new garments, old wineskins and new wineskins. He says in Mark chapter 2, beginning in verse 21, no one sews a patch of unshrunk cloth on an old garment. Otherwise, a new piece will pull away from the old, making the tear worse. He says you got a nice shirt, a nice sweater, something, some article of clothing that's really worn in. You've worn it a lot, and you've washed it again and again, and all those fabrics are all stretched as far as they need to go where it's really nice and comfortable, and you get a hole in that favorite shirt. You don't take just a brand new piece of cloth to patch that up. Because the first time you wash it and throw it into the dryer, what's going to happen to the new piece of cloth? It's going to shrink because it hasn't been stretched out yet. And when it does, what's it going to do? Pull away from the old cloth. Y'all with me? Stretch it. Make the hole even worse than what it was. He says no one, he goes on to say, no one puts new wine in old wineskins. And we don't usually use wineskins nowadays. But back in this time, they would take animal skins and they would, you know, the leather skins, and they would sew those things together. And they would put wine in them. And they would put new wine in a new wineskin. The fermentation process, that wine continued to ferment inside of that skin. It would stretch, and the strings that they had sewed it together with would stretch, and so it would hold on to those contents. Now, you think about that leather that's been stretched as far as it will go. You put some new wine into there, that fermentation process, those gases start to expand again. What's going to happen? It's going to burst open. And now all that wine, Jesus says, is going to run all over the place, and it ruins the wineskin, and it ruins the wine. He's not giving a lesson on clothing and winemaking. He's asking a question, which one are you? An old garment or a new garment? An old wineskin or a new wineskin? And even in that, he's not talking about old versus young and you can't teach an old dog new tricks and those kind of things. He's asking, how willing are you to be stretched? There are older people who are new wineskins. They take direction from God. They take things that are put on their heart by the Holy Spirit that are brand new, that they've never tried before, that's going to stretch them beyond their comfort zone, and they jump right in and they do it. And there are 20-year-olds that are old wineskins that have decided this is who I am, this is who I'm going to be, I don't want to change, I don't want to be different. Don't ask me to do something outside my comfort zone. Don't ask me to volunteer. Don't ask me to give more. If you do, it's just going to make my life worse, so just don't even ask. This isn't about age. This is about heart. How willing are you to be stretched beyond what makes you comfortable? If you're going to be truly committed to whatever change needs to happen in your life, whatever change it is that God has put in on your heart, the question is, how willing are you to be stretched in order to make that change happen? I have to be committed to making my marriage better. I have to be committed to being more honest in my friendships. I have to be committed to truly stopping the same habit that I've been saying for years I want to stop, even if it makes me uncomfortable. Even if it stretches me. Even if I don't know what the end result is going to be. I want to be committed, even if I don't know what the end result is going to be. Jonathan's armor bearer couldn't have known exactly how this is going to turn out. It could be successful. We could win. It could be a horrible failure. We may not even make it across the valley before they pick us off with an arrow or a spear. But Jonathan's armor bearer was committed to the action and committed to the process, even if he couldn't predict the result. Oh, that makes us uncomfortable. When people ask us to do something new or to do something we haven't tried before or haven't tried in a long time, we want to know what the end result's going to be first. And we want to have some kind of guarantee, some kind of assurance that everything's going to turn out okay or that things are going to be wildly successful on the other side of it. And if we can't get that kind of guarantee, no thanks. We stand at the edge, attached to the rope, ready to go over the side, and we don't know, we've never seen ourselves go 200 feet down and make it safely. So we don't even try. We may be called to change some habits in our lives, to do some things different, to give more than what we've been giving, to volunteer more than what we've been volunteering, to have a conversation with somebody who needs to know Jesus, and we know they need to know Jesus, and it's on our hearts, and yet we never have taken the initiative to have that conversation. And yet, I don't know how it's going to turn out. So I'd rather not even try. God is seeking the kind of commitment from us that says, I want to commit to this. I want to do this heart and soul, even if I don't know exactly what God's going to do with it. There's a man that's talked about in the Old Testament, the book of Genesis, the first book of the Bible. His name is Abraham. And Abraham was living over in the Middle East in the area of what would be modern day Iraq. And God comes to him and says, I want you to go. I want you to pack up your family, move away from your friends, move away from your home, move away from everything that you know, and go to a land that I will show you, which ended up being where modern-day Israel is nowadays. Now, imagine God coming to you and going, I want you to pack up everything in your house and take your family and move away from everything that's comfortable and everything that you know and your job and everything that's secure, and I want you to go. And even if you thought, okay, I'm going to do that, where are we going, Lord? I'll just tell you. Well, how far? I'll tell you. Well, how am I going to know I'm going to get there? I'll tell you. You go until I say stop. Who's signing up for that? I didn't see very many hands. That stretches, doesn't it? That takes commitment. It took commitment on Abraham's part, and he did it. He packed up and walked until God said, congratulations, you're here. In Hebrews chapter 11, the Hebrew author says, by faith, Abraham, when called to a place he would later receive as his inheritance, obeyed and went, even though he didn't know where he was going. I don't even know what the end result is going to be. I don't even know why God is telling me to do this, but he's telling me to do it, so I'm going to go. What kind of church would this be if we all had that kind of commitment? What kind of things God would do in Northwest Arkansas if we chose to go where he is putting on our hearts to go without even knowing the end result? But we have a hard time sometimes committing to things when we don't know what the end result is going to be. And even though, and Paul says in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, we walk by faith. We move forward by faith and not by sight. We're scared to death of what the end result might be or what might happen. Or we've seen bad things happen and things not work out well for other people. And so because of that, we don't want to try. Years ago when I was doing youth ministry, I had a bright idea one time. I had about, I don't even remember how many kids, a room full of kids, and we were going to go on a scavenger hunt for this one little gold trophy thing that I had. And I hid it somewhere in the church building. And we had all these kids in this room, and I blindfolded half of them. Just with, you know, some handkerchiefs. Blindfolded half of them. And I said, okay, your job is to partner up with somebody. And your partner, they can't touch you, they can't physically touch you, but they can give you instructions. And I want all these blindfolded people, I want you to be blindfolded, and I want you to find this treasure that I've hidden. And so they were supposed to go anywhere that they could in the church building. And the church building that we were in at the time had these, or I mean, it still has these big concrete block, cinder block walls. So they all start heading out of the classroom, some of them blindfolded. And one of them thought it would be funny to say instructions to somebody who wasn't his partner. And so I have a blindfolded kid, his name's Jake, and this is this long hallway, and he's come out the door, and he's kind of baby stepping, and he gets facing down this long hallway, and he's waiting for his next instruction. And before his partner could come out the door, somebody else said, go, man, just go, just go. And he thought it was his partner, and he just takes off running as fast as he can. Well, at the end of the hallway comes to a T, and he didn't know that, or he forgot, or whatever. He's just running full speed. Doesn't slow down. Right into the concrete, the cinder block wall. Didn't break his nose, made it bleed a little bit. So I guess he wasn't running that fast. But he's running full speed. Blindfolded. Bam. From that time on, anytime that we played a game of blindfolds, you think he wanted to play? No. Because it turned out bad. We don't know what the end result is, or we've seen it not work out well for somebody else. So we don't even want to try. That's not the commitment that God's looking for. God says there's things that need to change in your life. There's something that needs to be different, and I know you don't know what the end result is, but I need you to trust me. I need you to move forward. I'll take care of you. You won't smack your face on the wall. I know what the end result is. You just need to move. That's the kind of commitment God needs from us. Last story. Another youth ministry story. I think I've shared it with this church family before, so I'll give you the very abbreviated version. We had a bunch of teenagers at a ropes course where you have all these different high and low elements, this obstacle course kind of things you're trying to do. I had a young lady named Katie in the youth group, and Katie was scared to death of heights. And one particular element that we were trying to get the kids to do was climb up this tree and attach from this tree to a tree about from me over to the other side of our worship center was a long cable to walk on. And high above that was another cable, and attached to that cable periodically were ropes hanging down. Like you would see Tarzan swing on, just kind of jungle ropes. And so you had a rope there by your tree that you would hold on to. And then you would step out and you would reach for the next rope and you would hold on to that and get your balance while you're on this cable. Did I mention you're about 30 or 40 feet up in the air? I probably shouldn't have mentioned that part. And so then you let go of this rope and you move on to this one. And then you let go, you grab hold of this one, you let go, and you just keep moving. Now, she had a helmet on, and she was attached by a rope and rings to where if she lost her balance, she was not going to plummet to her death. They make it all safe. But she was scared to death. And she had a hold of the first rope, and they intentionally put the second rope just out of reach for most people, where you would have to shift your weight and actually be letting go of this one so that you could grab a hold of this one. It was a step of faith. And Katie stood there doing this for the longest time, almost willing that rope to come to her. And she kept reaching, and she kept reaching, and it wasn't there. And her legs, balancing on that cable, started to shake and started to tremble. And finally she said, I can't do it. I don't want to do this. I don't want to do this. And we kept encouraging her. Katie, you can do this. You can do it. You're going to be fine. Just reach. You can do it. And she kept shaking and kept saying, no, I don't want to do it. And finally they just let her down to the ground from where she was, because she couldn't make that leap. I don't fault her. It stretched her beyond what she wanted to do. I recognize that sometimes I'm Katie. God is calling me to have a conversation that's going to be awkward and weird for me. God is calling me to do something that I've never tried before, or volunteer in some way. God is calling me to give when I think, man, I don't have it to give. God is moving me to do something that maybe I've never tried before, and I'm reaching, and oh, that's too far. I can't do it. I don't want to be that kind of man. I don't want us to be that kind of people. I don't want us to be that kind of church. The Apostle Paul says in Romans chapter 12 and verse 1, I challenge you, I urge you, I beg you to become living sacrifices. Surrender your will to his will. Be a living sacrifice, and this is how you praise God and bring glory to God, is by committing to whatever it is that he's calling you to do and to wherever it is that he's calling you to go. Here's the thing. Most sacrifices, especially back in this time, were dead animal carcasses. That animal didn't have a choice in being sacrificed. It was killed and his body was thrown up on the fire. What does he challenge us to here? I challenge you to be what? Living sacrifices. A living sacrifice can climb down off the altar. It is your choice. God is not going to make you do anything. God is going to call you to move forward and to be different and to commit to something, but it's your choice. It's your choice as to whether you're going to let go of what's safe and what's normal and the rut that you're in and take a step and grab hold of what it is that God's calling you to. Can you do it? Will you do it? Some of you this morning need to take the step of giving your life to Jesus Christ for the first time because you never have before. And we're going to invite you to do that in just a moment. When we stand together and sing a song, we invite you to come forward and say, I'm ready to confess his name. I'm ready to invite him into my heart and make him the Lord of my life. I'm ready to repent of my sins. I'm ready to put him on in baptism. It can happen today. You can take that leap today, and it is so worth it. Some of you have been stuck for weeks, months, years, in the same addiction, with the same attitude, with the same hurt, with the same laziness, complacency. And God is calling you this morning to move forward, to let go of what has been your norm and claim something new. And he has something incredible prepared for you and something incredible prepared to do through you. Will you do it? If you're scared to take that leap, we invite you to walk forward this morning and say, I'm ready to do something different. I just don't know what it's going to look like, and I'm scared. Will you help me? Will you pray for me? We will. We will do whatever we can to help you take that step. But folks, let's take it. Let's commit together. Let's be a committed people together, and let's start today. If we can help you in any way, we want to. While together we stand and sing, please come forward.